interested in real estate investing but not quite sure where to get started? Do you want to get the know-hows on creating ongoing passive income using the buy and hold strategy? Hi, I'm Janice Bowles, licensed realtor and co-founder of B Premier Ventures, a real estate development and consulting firm where we buy and beautify distressed real estate, renovate it, and resell for profit. With over 15 years of investing experience, B Premier has extensive knowledge in rural land development, flips, and rental acquisitions. B Premier's current portfolio consists of properties within Florida and Virginia. Services includes investor project consulting, project management, and group coaching. For more information, visit our website at bpremierventures.com and schedule a complimentary discovery session or subscribe to our email list. It's free. Follow me on Instagram at Janice Bowles for additional real estate investing tips. B Premier Ventures, we buy and beautify.
Hey everybody, welcome to today's episode of Let's Do It Talk Show. It's your girl, LaDreen Howard Peterson, the CEO and founder of Do It, delivering on ideas and thoughts. And you know what I do in a nutshell, I help to turn dreamers into doers, and I do it from two aspects. I do it from the aspect of career development, resume writing, career coaching. You looking to change your job, you have an issue on your job, yes, I'm your girl. And then from a business standpoint, if you're looking for a marketing strategy, you need help with creating a business plan, or you have ideas and thoughts and don't know where to start, guess what? Yes, I am your girl. Here at the Let's Do It Talk Show, we were created for entrepreneurs. However, we know and feel that an entrepreneur has all different aspects of their life. So we talk about faith, we talk about finances, we talk about the future from career and also entrepreneurship, and then we talk about family and relationships. So today's episode is actually a bonus. So every now and again, we get a fifth Monday of the month. So what I decided to do is have guest hosts to come on and talk about various topics. So right now we're in the theme of Black Lives Matter, and we're going to continue into that theme. So a couple topics that we're going to be talking about are around Black Lives Matter, but the theme is 8:46, which represents 8 minutes and 46 seconds as it relates to George Floyd. But also we're going to talk about four major words: impact, implore, imagine, and implement. So before we jump into the show, I'm going to do how I always do, and I'm going to share with you about my weekend. So this weekend with COVID-19, it hasn't been too much going on, but this weekend, one of the fun things that I did was I had a pretend vacation, and my candle happens to say vacation, and it smells of like the ocean. So I sat on my deck and I really relaxed and ate crabs, cooked some shrimp, and ate those as well. The sad thing that happened was one of the young men in my community got hit by a car. So with that, it was very, very, very challenging for me. And it was, I was walking on my regular walk, and the young man goes up in the air. He was riding a bike. He flies up in the air. His bike flies up in the air. When he lands, his body is like imprinted on the car, and his head is like imprinted in the windshield. But thank God he got up. He got up, and of course, all of the grown-ups and the people who were in the car set him down and, you know, told him to sit still. And he was like, he's fine. He was very coherent, and he said he was, you know, he was a little dizzy, but thank God for touching him and blessing him. Outside of my community, once you go to all the way to the end, it is a main, very busy main street. And hopefully and prayerfully, the kids learn a lesson not to go beyond that point. But it was certainly a blessing. If you had seen that car, I kind of thought it was a done deal. So it had me really, really, really shaken up. And shout out to everybody on Facebook who said a prayer for him as well. And then one other thing, sending prayers up to one of my close friends, Wandy. She had a successful medical surgery. I'm not going to go all into her business, but God bless her. And she has shared it on Facebook, and she is recuperating. A lot of years in the waiting, but everything is going to be all right. So glory be to God. So in terms of our guest today, so basically it went about throughout some of the topics, because we've been on Black Lives Matters for the past month or so. And as we've been talking about them, we had several people who were heavily commenting in the feed for each one of the shows. And they are here today, and they are have agreed to be guests. So I'm going to mention their names, and then they will do self-introduction. So first, we have the lady who's joining us, who is none other than LaTosha Briscoe. Hey, Tasha. Can you share with the audience a little bit about you, who you are? Let them know who you are.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. So I am, again, LaTosha Briscoe. I'm the owner and creative director of LB Innovations Events. I am also a creative strategist, so I help people create plans and put them into action. So we don't just talk about what we're going to do. We actually strategize and implement. I'm a community member, and I serve my community in many different ways. So I wear a lot of hats for a lot of different organizations, and I'm not here to recite all of that, but just here to share and provide my input.
Awesome, awesome. Excited to have you here. Again, thank you for all your input that you have been putting in the feed. So I know even from today, it's going to be a very engaging conversation. Next up, we have Major Bandy, who is no stranger to the show. He was on the show previously when we talked about Saved, Sanctified, and Soul Southeast. Major is one of my childhood friends. So Major Bandy, Mr. Major Bandy, welcome back to the show. And can you give a little spiel about who you are?
Thank you, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm Major Bandy. I'm a War 8 child, raised and born in Southeast. You know, hey, it is what it is, you know, but I'm this type of person that, you know, that God, you know, chose me to live a different life, you know, and I never forgot where I come from. That's why I'm always active in War 8, you know, whatever they have, I'm a part of it. That's just how I am, you know, true man of God. And I just thank God for changing my life around. And just celebrate 1 year marriage anniversary, which is the 22nd of this month, and a birthday, which was the 26th of this month. So that's who I am.
Congratulations and happy birthday to you, and congratulations to you and your wife. So last but certainly not least is Kevin. I was about to call him my partner. Kevin was on the show last week, and he has been on several of our shows. Kevin is Kevin. So Kevin, can you tell everybody a little bit about you?
Again, man, to piggyback off my man, you know, War 8. Born and raised, you know, I see life differently now. So I want to try to share with people some of the things that I've been through to kind of help them elevate to a different path than, and not go through some of the stuff that I went through. So I mean, that's kind of what I'm here to do, and I'm also here to share my opinion on everything tonight. So thank you.
Yeah, that's what's up. So you all, as I mentioned, we are going in terms of Black Lives Matter. So for this particular show, I definitely, the theme 846 just kept playing in my head. So many different people and so many different things have been said and categorized into the 846. And we all know what it represents. Last week on the show, Kevin was preparing for this show, and he actually did 846. 8 minutes and 46 seconds of a video, and it was phenomenal. But I wanted to do it a little teeny bit different, because that's kind of a long time for someone to sit and go through. But that's like the important piece of it. That's the piece that when we focus on that, that's where we actually feel the pain of what happened. Like 8 minutes and 46 seconds. So when the activity is going on, because people are hollering and the young lady's moving the camera around a little bit, it's still a long time, but we can endure it a little more. But when you're doing the countdown of it, or it's intentionally focused on the 8 minutes and 46 seconds, it just like breaks my heart. Anytime that I began to focus on that, that was like beyond murder. It was just like the worst thing that that you can pretty much think about. So again, we're gonna go through four different areas: impact, implore, imagine, and implement. And we're gonna have an open dialogue, just round discussion of how each one of us feel about the various things that are going on. And please chime in on Facebook as well. So we'll all be looking and be able to capture anything that's highlighted or any questions that come up. So we're gonna go into the first topic, which is impact. And we're gonna start off with a video. And impact is to have a direct effect or impact on, impinge on.
Can you see someone's breaking into it right now?
No, it's all open, it's under construction. And he's running right now, there he goes right now.
Okay, what is he doing?
He's running down the creek.
I'm an off-duty officer. I thought it was in my apartment, and I shot a guy thinking that he was thinking it was my apartment.
You gave me a shoulder when I needed it.
I saw my son come in the world, and seeing him leave the world is not something that I want to see ever.
And you made me laugh when I was losing it.
The police shooting that resulted in the death of an EMT.
As we walk, we must make the pledge that we shall always march ahead. We cannot turn back. There are those who are asking the devotees of civil rights, when will you be satisfied? We can never be satisfied as long as the Negro is the victim of the unspeakable horrors of police brutality. We can never be satisfied.
Give it to you. And if death was coming for you, I'd give my life for you.
Yeah, so that video, so shout out to my church, Mount Enon Baptist Church. Being on the media ministry has its privileges. I can ask for permission for a video. But when I first saw that video during our church service, it seriously impacted me. And I have shared before that slavery, racism, and all of these topics are like a very tender spot for me. And in the past, I had really like run away from them. But it's here and it's in our face, so we're going to address these. So my first question on impact is, how has all of the videos of George Floyd, and not only him, of the others that we've seen, activities related to social injustice and politics impacted you? So more so, what are your current feelings? What are you feeling right now? So let's start with you, Tasha.
So I'm gonna say this, I have not watched the whole video because every time I tried to watch it, it just made my stomach hurt. Because before anything, job, community service, before any of that, I'm a mom.
Right.
So I have a black son. So to see a black son crying for his mother, like, that hurts.
Grown
man crying for his mother, that hurts. and to see human beings standing around watching, where is the humanity in that? And it's right. Like I went from anger to straight confusion, because I'm like, how in the world? Because you want to put yourself in the person, in someone's shoes, and you all, you know, we say, well, if I was there, I would have done this. There's no way on this earth that I could have stood there and watched that. Right. I would have been going to jail because I would have been interfering with police activity.
I feel you. And I honestly feel you on that. Again, that's why I try to shy away from different things like that. How about you, Major?
Oh, okay. Man, that's tough though. But yeah, I feel the same way she was just talking about. But see, now that the life that I live, I have to see things in a different, you know, a different way. But you already know, as just growing up in Wilder Place, you know, we like family. And like she said, how can you just stand there and watch that happen? You know, nobody trying to bum rush the police off or push them off the man or something like that. I know as we was coming up, you know, we had jump outs and police, but we, you know, we looked out for family around there. And it's terrible, like, you know, for a man. I mean, me as a man to cry out for my mother, that got to be, oh, my goodness. I mean, you know, because you're a man. The man was always taught to be strong, you know, and to, you know, defend yourself or defend others and stuff like that. But here you crying out like a child for your mother. Man, that just, like, blew me away. I was like, oh, my goodness. But I like I said again, I look at things in a different light. Way now, so I could get angry, but I just can't sin, so I can't have them thoughtful ways of, you know, revenge and stuff like that. But it come to your mind though. I just pray on it. That's it.
Yeah. Amen. And so one thing in terms of you, Major. I mean, a lot of Christians are in the Word, but they still have issues with this. But I definitely applaud you with that. That definitely helps, like, greatly. It helps greatly. But I cannot say that I have not had some thoughts and some other feelings in terms of why don't we just go ahead, half of us live, half of us won't, like, really getting, like, thinking radical for real, because it is, like, so disheartening. And then the fact that you would have thought that at George Floyd's death, that horrific scene that everybody saw, that would sort of be the end of it, right? But then we had things that happened, like, immediately, like, after that. So it's just like, I mean, like, what are we going to do? So they're taking me back to my South these days. But Kevin, how about you?
I mean, again, for me, it's disheartening. You know, I mean, we just had a conversation today, me and two of my brothers, man, and the conversation we had, you know, to be totally honest, man, my man was like, man, turn your phones off. We was like, what? He was like, no, literally turn your phone all the way off. And had a real conversation, kind of what you were saying, Drain, about what can be done as far as, I'm going to just say, being radical. Because at this point, you know, it's been going on for too long, and it's sad that when we have conversations, we can't even remember the amount of people that it's happened to. I mean, we know the instance. We know around what time it happened. We don't even remember their name. Remember when the dude, oh, yeah, oh, and remember the girl? And it shouldn't be casual conversation like that. So my impact is I'm sick of it. I mean, I'm going to tone it down a little because I know we got to be politically correct, but I'm sick of it. And I got a lot that I want to say. So on my platform, I said the way I want to. So I had an officer who I went to high school with, and I interviewed him. So I would, you know, ask everybody to go check that episode out. And because he said some things that I thought made sense, but also, you know, we probably didn't see eye to eye on everything. But, you know, I mean, I'm just tired of it. I'm tired of it. I can't no more.
Yeah, and honestly, like, for me, definitely tired of it. It makes me feel like I need to get involved. Like, previously, before, there has been, like, so much going on, and it did not start right now. But I think the fact that it's more televised, and with social media, the word gets around not only the word, but you actually get to see it. And with that going around so much, and people are able to relive it over and over and over again, or some people not even get through it, but they're watching a little bit by a little bit by a little bit, it is like now something has to be done. Because for one, for me, the impact is, okay, this is blatant. I don't care if you're yellow, white, purple, blue, pink, gray. I don't care what color you are. You saw that. And if you did not see it for what it was, it's no way like around it. And me, one of the things that I do, I always play like devil's advocate. That's what I do on my job. That's what I'm trained to do. And that's what I've always done, because I always want to look at the big picture of things and look at the opposite side or see it from somebody else's lens. So, y'all, I looked at it and played around with it in all different ways. And all roads lead to murder. All roads lead to murder. So whoever has any type of feeling that that wasn't as harsh as it was, they have a problem and they really need to go get checked out. The other thing that I feel in terms of my feelings and how I'm impacted about this, I appreciate our Caucasian white brothers and sisters stepping in and marching. And people can judge and say whatever they want or however they want. Because at the end of the day, my faith comes first. And I still look at it as we are one world under God. And that gives me like the hope that something has got to change, however it ends up going. But I do honestly feel that some people are more open to trying to understand. They will never, ever be able to truly understand what our ancestors feel. We won't be able to feel it 100%, but we know like what we received as a result of it. We know the different things that we have gone through for the color of our skin. So now what bothers me, but also as a point of enlightenment, the little kids, the younger generation realizing like, okay, hold on. I went to the school and I played with so-and-so, but wait a minute, when I step back, like this is really what's going on. So it's just openly racism to the point of all of the stuff that was done wrong before that we get to see it point blank. So again, I appreciate the genuine. We don't know who's genuine from our race, but I appreciate the genuine Caucasian people that are going down. But my other thing is they will never be able to understand. And I said I have white friends. My official mentor is a white man. But the thing about this, they will never ever be able to understand. But the thing is, like when them having white privileges, if they are willing to give it up, then I'm okay with that. So that's my question, is we get to that point when they are willing to give it up. That's my stance. And Kevin, like, I don't even want to go deep into like what you're saying, but I feel your friends because it almost leaves us with nothing to do. And then the latest video with the president and the people with racial slurs and white supremacies, and he gets to say like, oh, I didn't see it and take it back. Come on now, like, I don't know what they're thinking or who they think they're playing with in terms of that. So, yeah, so, and you all can drop your information into the feed in terms of what you feel. So we're gonna go to the second component, which is implore. So from the standpoint of implore, it is to make an earnest request to someone to say something as a request in a sincere or urgent manner. So right now, we need some help. We need some people to stand up. We need some leaders. We need some bridging of the gap. And I appreciate the young people who are out there and ready to make moves and out there marching. But someone needs to explain to them and share with them some of the historical knowledge so that when they go and march and they're going in peace and then something negative happens, somebody get locked up or it turns to not be peaceful, and then they don't understand. So these are some of the things that someone really needs to help them out and enlighten them. So my question, although we have been faced with a lot of racism and moments looking as if the needle has been pushed or that progress has been made, and I feel like it's different this time, I honestly do, but what one message or point would you like to send to the world as encouragement to continue in this fight? So we'll switch it up. So Major, let's start with you first. What word of encouragement would you send out to give people, to tell them, don't give up?
Okay, what I could just say, you know, within your life, just put, you know, God first. Let God be your first priority. You just got to hear from God, you know. That's just the bottom line. I know sometimes we want to go out and do things on our own, but you got to realize that, you know, this battle is not ours. You know, the battle we fight been going on since our grandparents, great-grandparents, and stuff like that. So racism and all this stuff been around for a long period of time. And as I watch the protesters, you know, out there, I'm a 60 baby, you know what I'm saying? So I was a young boy at the time when my mother and grandmothers and it was out there, you know, protesting and stuff. So we could drink from the same water fountain as white people. We go into the restaurant as white people, sit down and eat. You know, they fought. And all I see is the repeating itself with our younger generations. Now they out there doing the same thing. Then you also got to be mindful and aware of some people use protesters as a way of destroying stuff and, you know, messing up stuff. So yeah. About protesting, you got to just make sure when you out there, it got to be an assignment for God that you out there, because guess what? Because you put yourself out there into something, even though somebody else that's not a part of y'all but out there protesting, destroying stuff, you're going to receive that bad name. So that your name going to be stamped on that. So that's the only thing about protesting. I don't have anything against it, but as our young generation that's out there, they need to be mindful of what protesting is. Yes, we understand, you know, racism, and they seem like they're killing all our young black men, and they doing all this. But we got to understand something. We got to be mindful that we also are doing the same thing to our young generation. We shooting each other down. We killing each other. And to fight a war, you know, you need power. You need people to fight a war, and we can't do it without when we killing our own self. And then now we worrying about what the white people are doing, the racists. It's been around a long time. It's still going to be around. Long people be around, because I found out something. People's mindset got to be changed before they can order to change. If you brought up in a white generation, they're saying black people is underneath you. They supposed to be slaves, because when we came over here, we were slaves. So that's the way they look at us, as slaves. So, I mean, when we go out there to fight and protest or do what we have to do, just be mindful and just understand that God is going to be the only way that we get through this. We got to pull together as a family. We can't fight war between ourselves and then try to fight war between somebody else, because it's not going to work that way.
Man. I can virtually high five you on that one. So one of the things that I have honestly been trying not to do is pull in internal activities and issues such as black on black crime. Like it's an issue that we have to address, and I'm not like trying to cover it up or run away from it. It's just that the title of my topics and the purpose that, of our show at a given time has not been that topic. But trust and believe, we will be going back and we will be having discussions about that, because one of the things, we will never, ever, ever be able to successfully heal and come together to make progress unless we really like open up and start addressing the real issues, start understanding and paying attention to the things that goes on. So Major, you definitely hit on to a number of things. And I think I was talking, Kevin and I was talking about it. And I was saying like, this is not the show for that, but definitely have to address that, because the same time when something was going on in front of the White House, something was going on in Northeast that was black on black. So you definitely hit a point on that, and we will definitely have to have another show about that, because we have to get to the root of the issues if we are going to come together and really make a difference and make an impact on this huge problem that's going on. And then I'll say, like, everything that you said about God, touche, I agree with you, but you definitely made some great points, like, to end it all. But I will circle back on that, because that's where my response, it gears towards that. Kevin.
So I honestly think I would implore that, you know, it's power in numbers. Like, we all have to be like-minded. We all have to kind of be on the same page. We can't be saying this message, that message. No, what is our main demand right now? You know, I mean, I can't say what that demand is, but, you know, what is the number one demand for us, for black people right now? And we need to go out there and we need to strategically put it out there. You know, I mean, I understand, and I'm not saying that I'm against, you know, the rioting as well, because I can understand, you know, as being a young man, I can remember, you know, doing some things now that I actually am thinking about while I'm speaking to y'all, and it just makes me smile, because it's like, I do not react that way anymore. And that word react, it means that you're not thinking about the communities that you're destroying. You're not thinking about, you know, the stuff that you're tearing up. You're not thinking, because you're reacting. So it's a big difference between reacting and responding. And now at 42, I'm trying to respond to things versus react. You know what I mean? So I would implore that we, you know, come together. You know, I know that's not going to be easy. I know that's not going to be an easy feat. Everybody don't think the same way. Everybody don't have the same ideologies. But, you know, I might not understand Muslims, but I do understand that most of them that I know, they good people. You know, I know some, you know, white people that, you know, Seventh-day Adventists and, you know, all these other religions, it don't matter. You know, if we go out in the street and get shot by a straight bullet, we all gonna bleed red. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it does not make a difference for real. I mean, on some just being real with y'all, it should not make a difference. If we want to see a change, it has to be in numbers. And again, just to piggyback off you saying with the white people, you know, I just think that it's somewhat of an ignorant mindset, because it's almost like, do you want them to be against us, or do you want them to be with us? So
right.
I mean, for me, it's like, you know, you can't have it both ways. You know what I mean? You can't want them to help you, but then turn around and say, forget them because they're trying to help us. Nah, which don't make sense. So I would implore people to, you know, get the education that they need, you know, whatever history lesson they need, you know, to get caught up on speed. Because one of our issues is we don't know where we come from. We don't know who we are. We don't know how we got here. And I mean, I'm still doing that myself. And I just feel like we got to unite and become one. We got to stop gritting on each other. We got to stop not speaking to each other when we see each other on the street. Man, what's up, champ? What's good? Hey, how you doing? You good? Yeah, I'm good, man. Or you might find out something about somebody that they having a messed up day. You can probably feed into them. You know, give them $1, $5, whatever. We just got to be better to each other, man. We got to be better to each other.
Yep. How about you, Tasha?
Yep. So I'm really just going to piggyback off of what was already said, because it requires a mindset change and a heart change. And, you know, we always want to point back to our past, but we have to remember we are not our ancestors, and neither are the white folks that are around today. So we need to keep in mind, just like we say, you know, or we would have handled things a certain way back then, and we were brought over as slaves. We can say that now because we weren't there. But we also have to keep in mind, a lot of the white people that are here today, they were not raised on stories that their ancestors were slave owners who beat people and murdered people and raped people. Some of them were told, oh, they were just wealthy people and they own lots of land and they own plants. They heard the good side. They didn't hear the horror stories. And so we have to keep that in mind, that they may have been raised in an ignorant manner where they really don't know the truth about their history, where, you know, black generations, we were told stories that were passed down. And we had to learn our history that way, because we didn't get all of our history in books. We didn't get all of our history in school. So we had to learn it from the people that lived it. And it was passed from generation to generation. And so now, like it was mentioned, it progression requires unification. We can't do this on our own. We cannot march to the Congress and expect change when you're 80% of your Congress is white folks. It ain't going to happen like that. It doesn't matter what your party line is, what your political view is. That's why I try not to put politics above all of this. Like, it requires that mindset change. You got to get people to understand wrong is wrong and right is right and change is necessary. Because until you can get people to understand that, nothing else matters, because people are going to continue to live the way they live as long as it does not affect them. And that's just, you know, like you said, we're seeing a lot of things now because we got social media and nothing else is going on in the world. So everything's on repeat on the news. We're seeing it. And young folks are getting angry. They're getting mad. They're out here protesting. But look at the civil rights movement. That didn't happen overnight. So do I think that we've seen some change in the past few weeks? Yes, I do. A lot of things have changed. You got police departments shutting down. You got counties and local entities that are putting in citizen review boards. So I do see change it being implemented, but it's a slow change and it's going to take time. Civil rights movement, you looking at, that was 14, 15 years of continuous work. But like Kevin said, everybody was on the same page. There was not this person saying this thing one day and another person saying another thing. No, they had meetings in people's living rooms and they said, this is what we're focusing on today. Tomorrow, we're going to boycott the buses.
Right.
Next week, we're boycotting the laundromat. This is how we're going to do it. And everybody was on the same page. We get too wishy-washy, and if it doesn't fit our, you know, our current mood, or if it's going to make us uncomfortable, everybody doesn't want to agree or they don't want to support. Right. And then everybody wants to have a platform and be the superstar of the show. So that's a whole another issue. That's a different show topic. Yeah. But everybody got to be on the same page. If we all want the same results, I don't care what organization you belong to or whatever it may be, there's a way you can sit down at the same table and say, this is what we're going to do, and we're going to walk in this together. And that's the only way to get this done. And you need Black people, you need white people, you need whoever is on board for change. Because regardless of how it's affecting you now, once we continue to hit people's pockets, everybody's going to be affected regardless.
Yes, yes. So, all of y'all definitely hit on great points. Major with that mindset, it's nothing more tragic than to have someone that's stuck in an unhealthy mindset. The ability to shift your mindset and enlighten yourself and understand things, that's how progress happens. So for me, my factors and the solutions that I have is education and God. And I don't only mean education in terms of going to college, getting your degree and things like that. The one thing that I can remember my mother and my teachers telling me is, like, despite everything that goes on in the world, nobody can ever take your education away from you. Whatever you learn, whatever you know, and whatever you gather information up, continuously learn and continuously to grow. And that will put you in a powerful position, not necessarily a powerful position in an organization, but to be able to think, understand, and filter and find your way through life. So don't fall for the okie doke. Don't be uneducated going around and doing various things. Check history, learn about different phases and different things that are going on so that you are well prepared. Study your opponent. Like, you don't win just by you just being prepared. It's the whole totality of it. So study the opposite portion about it. No, you will never be able to understand the other party. They will never be able to understand us. But as we begin to work together to try to figure out, it almost like it has to come to some point is where we begin to respect one another and try harder to understand one another. And then the second one, of course, in terms of God from a spiritual standpoint. So it's so many things that are going on, so many things that happen. People have so many different theories in terms of COVID-19 making everybody pretty much shut down. You're locked down. So it's only so many things that you can do that it like forced people to think about different things and just find themselves in a space of settling down. So that when this issue happened and the various things happen, you're more alert. So my thing is like, definitely from the educated part, stay woke. But from a spiritual standpoint, make sure that you stay focused and you understand that God is on the throne. There's nothing that's happening right now that God can't just snap his finger and say, shift back. There's lessons, there's reasons why, because everything that he's doing work together. So that is what has been able to keep me sane, and that has been able to keep me the level of peace that I have, is knowing that God still sits on the throne. And one of my neighbors, I was talking to her, and she actually asked me this question. She asked me, like, with everything that's going on, every component of it, like, say something. And I was like, say something. And she said, yes. So immediately I went straight to the Bible verse, 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and will heal the land. So God loves the white people. God loves the black people. God loves everybody. So trying to figure out what's going on in their head while they're trying to figure out what's going on in our head. What if? What if? So we have no idea in terms of what God has going on in terms of all the components. So the only thing that I know to do is be obedient, but stay woke and get educated furthermore about my history. And it's just a tough lesson that I got to go through, because it really breaks my heart and it hurts me to the core, like seeing things and reading things about slavery in our ancestors. But in order for me to better position myself, it's just the things that we have to go through, because we have to be prepared for what's coming, and nobody knows what it is. We can speculate and we can feel and we can say, and nobody knows what it is, but God doesn't make any mistakes. So that's my piece in terms of in that. Educate yourself and humble yourself and pray to God and understand and put your trust in him and know that he still sits on the throne. He still sits on the throne, no matter how ugly it looks or how complicated it looks. God still sits on the throne. So the next one that we go into is imagine. Imagine. So Kevin, we're going to put up the post and then you get ready. We're going to start with you first. So imagine is to use the imagination to form a mental image of something not present. So if you could imagine how you would like for it to be, or imagine what would it take for this world to come together to be a better place, what would you imagine?
I hate to be so generic, but I'm gonna say love. I mean, because love really conquers all, man. I mean, if you really love for another individual, if you really care for them, you would want to do for them. You would want to help them. So that's kind of where I'm at. Love.
Yeah, that's not generic at all, because the Bible tells you that out of all things, love is the most important, the love of others. So no, you kind of like hit it on the nail right there. So there you go. Tasha, how about you?
Yeah. So when I first heard the word, I was like, man, I don't know, because we could imagine so many things, but right now it's hard to see that. But when he mentioned love, and that's the basis for everything. Like, you can't have hate against anyone or any situation if you have love. And I think that's what's stopping a lot of the progress from happening, because people are harboring hate versus focusing on the issue and focusing on the resolution. So I'm going to steal your answer, and I'm going to say my answer is love.
Hey, I like it. So we got 2 out of 4 so far. And one moment, I just want to read the question that I was putting out there. I just skipped, got all excited, waiting for my answer to come. Many people know that I'm a huge dreamer, and my thoughts and imagination run wild. One of my favorite songs, John Lennon's Imagine, and favorite historical speeches is Dr. Martin Luther King's excerpt, I Have a Dream. These are the drivers that reflect some of the ways in which I can imagine for the future. What do you imagine, or how do you project the next year or two will be in terms of progress? So Kevin, love. Tasha got a little bit, but it all Rosalie to love. So Major, how about you?
Hey, Dream, I'm glad you said that because that's my favorite two. But I can only imagine my song is from, I got to hear Tamela Mann sing that. I play that song a lot. That's my song right there. And I Have a Dream, that was good too, because I can remember when I was in the 7th grade that down Hart Junior High School that I did Martin Luther King, and I got to read that speech. Mm. And man, that to the day, you know, it still, you know, rings in my head and stuff like that. But the key thing, what the gentleman said, it's love, you know, because the Bible teaches us that, you know, first love God, you know, and second you love your neighbors. You know, how can you say, God said, how can you say you love me when you don't even love the people that you see every day? So we got to come to a point where we got to show love every day. Sometimes it hurts. Sometimes we come across people that we know don't like us, but you still have to show love. You won't know how much you probably mean to a person that's so evil and mean, and you just walk and shake their hand or hug them, say, you know, I love you. That might brighten up their whole day. Man, that was the key. When he said it like he didn't have that enthusiasm, like he was guessing it, but man, that was the powerful thing right there. That's the number one thing right there that this world needs is love. And that's the only way we're going to come on one accord, because we got to show love. That's the only way. Man, I love what he just said. That was it right there.
Yeah, pretty much, Kevin, you started it off. And definitely, I wouldn't, if I had another answer, I wouldn't say another one. But so mine is building into, like leading to directly into love. So my imagination is that God utilizes the young to help bridge us together. And I said on a previous show to use our elders, and I mean we're hitting up in terms of the age now, but use some of the people who have been through some stuff and understand the process to bridge the gap between our young blacks who are actually marching and fired up with our older people to build it so that what we're missing, the ingredients to really come together and make change, is there. But my other piece is that God uses the young people, that he used the young black people. Because right now, someone said it, they are angry. They cannot fathom like how these things have gone on to happen this way. They are outraged and they are willing to fight to do whatever they need to do to make a change. Their environment that our ancestors were in, that's not the environment of today. Although we know that there is blatant racism and there are other things that go on, there are some laws that protect us. So we have a better stance of continuing if we come together. But the other point is the young white kids. We have seen so many videos where they have been outraged to their parents of, like, one young girl was crying, like, I can't believe that y'all are racist. Like, and she had a whole debate with her parents defending black people. So if this continues to go on and our young minds are that open and they're ready to accept these things that have went on, whether it be because what they actually witnessed in their lifetime, because as you bring us like movements away from slavery, even some of our black people feel like we have a sense of entitlement, or we have been trained a different way as it comes along. Because some of our parents had a different way and a different in their era, how they dealt with white folks. Coming up to us, we have a different way. We knew like different things underliningly, but it wasn't like, it depended on the situation of how everything was in terms of defending yourself, whether it was going to the law or going to EEO. We still knew that some things weren't fair, but it wasn't so unfair that we wouldn't put up, I mean, not so unfair. It wasn't like a given at the beginning that we wouldn't put up a fight to see if it was going to be fair or how it was going to go in our favor. But I really think that through the young folks, that that they're going to be the ones that really make the melting pot a melting pot. And really be able to see one another more so in understanding. And again, these videos, not only from the black side, but from the white side and from different things that are going on, people are watching these videos. And again, some people are just straight racism, straight on white supremacists, and just cannot get the grasp of it. But those who are slowly feeling and understanding, even if they are given their level of compassion, even if they're at that point, even if they're not at that point of, oh, I want it to be equal, even if that means giving up my white entitlements and all of my white privileges. So it's just, I really think that, and I really can imagine God utilizing the children to bring everything together. And if they're loving one another and they're stressing out the point to make an impact on their parents, or even how many ever years that it has to go from the 16 year old in 5 years, they'll be 21. For those who are 25 in 5 years, they'll be 30. So I'm not necessarily saying that I think this thing is going to happen overnight, but God is just amazing. So in terms of what we're seeing, the little crumble of bread pieces that we're seeing to come together, I really have hope. And I really think that this time that it is impactful. Like it's more touching people in a way for the various reasons that we say on social media. But my final answer, all roads lead to love. So definitely what all of us said unanimously, love. So it wasn't generic of Kevin at all. That's like pretty much the key to what's to what we need. And then we'll move into the last one. The last one is implement. So implement is very important. That's to put a decision, a plan, an agreement, etc., into effect. So many times it's a lot of talk. It's a lot of talk that goes on, and not necessarily that people are talking to sell a wolf ticket or talking with the intent not to do anything, but implementing is more where you put actions in place of the things that you have said. So that's a critical point. So my question, and I'm gonna start with you first, Major. My question, every little bit helps. Our votes matter. Our voices matter. Within your everyday life, what are some steps that you will or have already begun to implement as your contribution to help our community, our world? And note, with this question, I want you all to wrap it up and give your close out as far as your information as well. So Major, implement. What have you done or what do you plan to do?
Okay. Reem, I'll read real quick Matthew 6:33. It said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Amen. I love that scripture. And what I would do, well, what I'm doing, and I'm already having place of doing, is going back out to our city. You know, I mean, a lot of people, you know, stay behind the church building, you know, the four walls, and preach the gospel. But right now, I got, you know, some people that's with me. We're going back out to the streets. We're going to hit southeast, southwest, northeast, and northwest. And we're going to fellowship out in the street. We're going to have church back in the street like it used to be back in the days. So I got a lot of people, you know, pulling with me on that, you know, because it's something have to be done. Like you say, it's, you know, action got to take place. We can sit here all day long and talk about what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. But until you get out there, you know, and do action, you know, action speak louder than words. And so that's something that, you know, I got set up the middle part of July, which is around the 12th or the 15th, something like that.
Okay.
But we're going to go out to the streets, go back to the neighborhoods. And, you know, we're going to have church outside, you know, and we're going to witness to people. I got some people that sing, you know, sing gospel. And, you know, especially Southeast, we're going to hit Southeast hard because that's where I, you know, raised and born. You know, I'm not scared to go back out to the streets where I ran the streets before, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
A lot of people are like, no, I'm not going over there. I'm not, you know, where everybody have their way of doing things. But this is something that I feel like I know that I'm going to do, you know, if you with me, you with me. If you not, you not, you know, because I walk, you know, I walk by faith and not by sight.
Amen.
So I know everything going to be all right because I got God on my side, and that's more than the whole world against me. So that's what I planned on doing. That's what I'm going to do. And I know it's going to be successful because I keep God in the midst of everything I do. God is my centerpiece, you know, and people need to hear that, you know, because everybody's not going to walk into a church building. Everybody's not going to pick up a Bible. Everybody, then some people don't know who our Savior is. You know, how you could tell somebody, you know, blah, blah, blah. But if you go, God, the Bible tells us to meet the people where they at.
Right.
And that's what I'm going to do. And that's going to be my logo, meet the people where they at.
Mm.
So I'm going to close out by saying, I'm on live Monday through Friday at 7 a.m. My name on Facebook is Bandy Major. I first put live, and all I do is talk about gospel, true gospel. How, you know, I don't sugarcoat anything. I keep it straightforward because that's how the word of God is. It, you know, some people like it and some people don't. All we got to do is continue to pray for it. And that's all I'm going to do.
Amen. Amen. And Major, I am so proud of you and everything that you do. I caught your live in the morning where you're giving the word like twice. But I'm so proud of you. Keep doing what you're doing. And your slogan, meeting people where they are, that's like perfect. And you already know your family. So my platform, however I can assist you, whatever I can do to continue to move the needle forward and continue to do God's work, by all means, you have my number. Just reach out to me. So thank you. Thank you so much. And I'm so proud of you.
Thank you very much, Drina. Thank God for being God. And I thank God for you giving me the opportunity to come on here and be a voice to be heard. I thank God for you also.
Amen. Amen. Tasha, can we go to you?
Yes. So what I'm doing, what I'm working on, what I encourage other people to do as far as implementation is getting involved. If you're one of those people that, you know, you want to talk about it, call your politicians and talk about it. Tell them what's on your mind. If you want to write about it, trust me, there are petitions out there because the legislation is being pushed. There's a lot of things that need change, and we can't just say we want change. We got to push that legislation through. And getting involved means not just showing up at a march or showing up at a rally, like getting out there and doing the work.
Right.
If you're not involved or associated with a church, you know, visit a church. Find one. We just heard street ministries coming back, so you can get associated with some street ministry. But find a church to get involved in so that you can get the work done, or find an organization. I'm a member of the NAACP, and most of my work through them, economic development. And I'm pushing minority economic development. So we're, you know, helping small businesses, especially minority small businesses, grow in our communities. And NAACP is, you know, one of the first organizations in this country that was built not just with Black people. That's a biracial organization that, you know, helped lead a lot of change in this country. And I advise people to get involved. If you can't find an organization, I don't know what you're missing because everything's on Google right now, but just being a part of that change. And like my pastor said on Sunday, you know, we got to support these young people that are out here making this history. You know, if we don't want to protest, don't talk about them protesting, but figure out a way we can support them. There's an organization out there, and I was trying to find the name while you were talking, and I cannot think of the name of it, but they offer opportunities for citizens to become legal observers during protests. So that means you sit in and you monitor what the police officers are doing and how they're reacting during these protest situations to make sure they aren't violating any laws or policies and that they're not abusing the protesters. And but you go through this whole training program and you become a legal observer. So I cannot think of the name. If I think of the name, I will drop it in the on the Facebook Live so that everyone can see it. But just getting involved, if you need to know resources or anything like that, like I can connect you with resources across the DMV, because between us, we have a ton of connections. So I'm not going to say I have them all, but I know we have a ton of connections, because there are people out there that are waiting for someone to say, go do this next, because they don't really know what to do, but they just want to show up and say they're involved in something. And, you know, we need feet on the street, but we also need people that are willing to make those phone calls and write those letters. And, you know, voter registration is a big push right now, because we got I think I heard the number today, over 4 million young people in this country that will be turning 18 this year, and they will be ready to vote. So we need all 4 million of them to get registered to vote. And we want to make sure that we're encouraging young people. You know, young people have a tendency of saying they don't trust the government. And I hear people saying they don't believe in voting, which I'm not even sure how that makes sense. But we need to educate people, have them understand how that one vote can make a big difference. So definitely, you know, stepping up and becoming the educators that we know we can be, because we've lived through some things or we've heard some things, and it's time for us to make sure that we're teaching the next generation so that they can be prepared. Because what we see now, these past couple months, this is nothing compared to what's going to come. Because as we know, the word says everything's going to be repeated. Nothing is new under the sun.
Right.
We just have to be prepared. And to be prepared, we have to make sure that we can get through this thing right now with that armor of God, so that when that next thing comes, we'll be ready for it. So, you know, reach out to me. I'm on Facebook, Latasha Briscoe. And I'm not even going to share any websites or anything, but if you find me on Facebook, Latasha Briscoe, I'll drop all my stuff on in the Facebook chat, because it's too much to type. But I, you know, I enjoy connecting with people, like-minded people, but watch who you consider your like-minded circle, because sometimes you might be being led in the wrong direction. So be mindful of that also. But, you know, this was great, Dreen. I'm glad you put this together to have this conversation, because we've heard so many different things and a lot of conversations that, you know, people were able to release their anger, but there was no discussion about, okay, how can I get involved and what we do next? So this was good. This is a good start. And I think that people need to just take heed and really take those next steps, because this isn't over with. We still have a lot of work to do.
Thank you so much, Tasha, and everything that you do. And I'm looking at your son. He was on my show before, and just continue to do the work through his eyes. So, Kevin, I'll let you go. I won't go into mine, because mine is about the youth. So, Kevin.
I was just going to say, we all kind of shared what we shared tonight, and I heard some similarities. I heard education. I heard, togetherness. I heard, a mindset, changing the mindset. I just feel like we've got to continue to keep that unified mentality, you know, at some point, you know what I mean, to allow us to bridge everything that we're going through, you know, out on the outside enemies, because there's always enemies coming to attack us. So, I mean, if you get used to being attacked all the time, at some point, you know, if you've been doing it a certain way, and you haven't been seeing the kind of change that you want to see, you got to switch it up and do something else.
Right.
So I just want people to know that, you know, you got to be your authentic self, I guess what I'm trying to say. Because normally when people see who you are, they kind of either go against you or kind of go with you, right? And so me, I try to stay my authentic self. Sometimes I stumble on words. Sometimes I forget a word. Sometimes I'm loud. Sometimes I'm not. I mean, I'm just myself.
Yeah.
So people generally say, the one thing they like about me is that I've never tried to change who I am, regardless, right? And I just kind of shoot straight from the hip based off a lot of my life experiences and things that I've been through. You know what I mean? So I think we got to just kind of be our authentic self. So that way, when we see each other in the street or when we connect with one another, we generally know and got a good idea for each other. I mean, because we like, okay, she do this, she do that. Maybe she can help me. I mean, it just opens up the doors for so many different conversations. People helping people, you know, get jobs. People helping people with, you know, lawyers or, you know, family members who locked up. I mean, you just never know, you know, how you can help a person if we communicate and show our authentic self. Because a lot of people, I heard somebody say something about walls. You know, even they talk about walls in relationships, people walk around with walls on because they want to kind of hide who they were. Like, when people see me, they be like, oh, yeah, I remember him. He was wild. I was. But now I'm not that person no more. And when people see me, they recognize my authentic self.
Yeah.
If I'm making sense, right?
Yeah.
So I think we just need to get back to who we are, you know, education, the love, all of that. But just be your authentic self.
Yeah, that was like really so on point. That's one of the things, like, I'm very educated, 2 master's degrees, so I can talk the talk, I could do whatever I need to do in a situation that I'm in. But one thing about me, always have been authentic through every aspect of what I do, because one, nobody can help you if you're being unauthentic, because they're helping the wrong thing. So I definitely think that you hit on something. Everybody hit on something great. So for me, mine is definitely like the youth. Looking and seeing what our youth are doing right now and our young adults, it's like so like rewarding and amazing to me. It is like icing on the cake for me. So to see this takes me back to when I used to heavily work with young kids. So I do it now through my I Am the Legacy campaign, but I mean heavily work with them on a monthly basis and connecting with them and guiding and teaching them through a couple things. So me and the owner of Urban Style Media, we have been into some like serious conversations of like what we can do. Because one, I said, like on my birthday, I just sat and went through my goals. I do this every year, but heavily a lot of the components related on what's going on now and what could I really do that I would impact and make a change. I don't care how small it was. And it was use my platform. So ever since the George Floyd case, all of the topics have been around Black Lives Matter, because we have to continue the fight that's going on. So mine is through young kids. The other thing that we know is economics. Economics. We know how successful Black Wall Street was. We know how it was when that thing broke down, right? So if you take the two of those, like God is already at the center and at the top and the focus of everything that I do. But the other underlying components of that is through education and through economics. And my goal, my passion, and my heart is driving me back to the youth. So look out and listen out for some additional activities, because I think that if we get them at the young age, the mindset and all the other things that everyone else said, that we'll be able to move the needle further along. But starting from the young ones up and educating them, you will be amazed at how a young mind can concept information if you feed it into them and you make it in a way that is understandable. And when you make it rewarding for them and very realistic, they will like engage in it to a whole different level. So shout out to everyone who has joined us. My God, mommy, hey, the other Ladrine, Carla Carter, Neek, our host, Michelle Bolden, Dee Bolden, Dana Cunningham, Andre Watts, Yvette Watts, Nicole Scott Hostin, Tawana Livingston, CeCe Bethea, Christine Brown, Family, Sunshine Howard, Sandra Hickman, Reverend Irene Smith, Latasha, Monica Roberts, everybody. Thank you all so much, Shanae. So many people just have been bouncing in and out, so we appreciate you. So what we're going to do, so next week, I'm going to bring some youth in. So I want to know, how do they feel about what's going on? What are some of the activities and the actions that they have feel from witnessing what has gone on? So that's what next week's show is going to be about. So LaDrean Howard Peterson on Facebook, Do It Deliverance on Instagram, and for the show, Let's Do It Talk Show on all different platforms. So what I want to leave you all with, so it is a video, 8 minutes and 46 seconds, where my pastor actually goes through illustration to explain some of the horror things as he lays in prostrate in terms of being on the ground. So thank you all so much for tuning in, and I will see you all next week. So please look at the video, share any comments that you have, and I will go back and read everything. So thank you all again, and Black Lives Matter.
Your knee off our neck.
What do you want?
I can't breathe. I will.
Get up.
I can't move.
Get up. Get in the car.
Mama.
Get up. Get in the car.
Mama.
Right.
8 minutes.
And 46 seconds. That's the amount of time former Minneapolis police officer Derek left his knee